Well, we do welcome everyone to our evening broadcast. Those from our own congregation here in Newton Abbey who are tuning in, we welcome you. Those from our Tyndale congregation as well, where I'm inter-moderator, we welcome you also. And all who have joined with us, we welcome you in the Saviour's name, and we pray the Lord will bless us, draw near to us this evening as we come around his word. We're going to commence with hymn number 265, I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. 265, do join in as the words come up on the screen. We're going to bow together in prayer and seek the Lord at this stage. Our God and Father, we do bow in thy presence in the Saviour's worthy name. And we do stand amazed in the presence of Almighty God as we contemplate the love of Jesus Christ and all that he has done for poor sinners. Oh, well, may we sing, how marvellous, how wonderful. And we thank thee this evening for the mercies of God toward us, the great provision made for us in Jesus Christ. For, Lord, we were lost and undone, perishing in our sins. We were under condemnation. Lord, we were on our way down that broad road to a lost eternity. But we thank thee for the Saviour, the one who came into this world, the one who came to take the sinner's place and die there as a substitute on Calvary's cross. And we thank thee for that day when he hung there on that middle tree and he gave his life and poured out his life unto death, shed his precious blood. And we thank thee that through him there is a way of approach this evening. Lord, we thank thee there's justification through the blood of the Lamb. And we thank thee that imputed righteousness that is ours this night for those who are in Christ. Lord, it brings us into thy presence. We thank thee we're accepted in the Beloved. And, O Lord, we rejoice in all that he is and all that he has done. And we pray that thou will bless us this evening as we gather in this fashion, wherever we may be. Lord, as we sing thy praises, as we come around thy word, we ask for a sense of the Lord's nearness. We pray for thy speaking voice to be heard. O Lord, draw nigh this evening, we ask. May there be that real sense that the Lord has come by and spoken to us. And we thank thee that on a Sabbath evening we can gather in this fashion. And though, Lord, not able in person to gather in the house of God, yet, Lord, to gather like this, we can come around the word of God. And we pray that thou indeed will bless us, draw nigh to us, rejoice our hearts. We pray that as thy people we might be glad in the Lord and all that thou hast done for us. And Lord, we would pray for any who listen in, who are unsaved, unconverted, who've never come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Saviour. And we pray for an opening up of their heart and their understanding. O Lord, convince them, we ask of thee, of their need of Christ. It is the work of thy Holy Spirit to do so. And we pray, therefore, that thy Holy Spirit will work in hearts and bring sinners unto thyself. Lord, enlighten the mind. Take the scales from off their eyes and enable them to see their need of Christ. Give them grace to call upon thee, that they might believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. O Lord, grant it to be so even tonight. We pray that thy word would be a saving word in some heart, that it would be mixed with faith in the heart of those who hear it, and that it would bring them unto thyself. So bless, we pray, glorify thy name in all things. Remember us in these times, Lord, in which we live. We pray that thou will accomplish thy purposes. O Lord, we believe that these things are under thy sovereign power and sovereign control. And Lord, they are sent for a purpose. And therefore we pray, accomplish thy purposes, O Lord. And may that purpose be a turning to thee, a humbling of this nation and other nations as well. Turning unto thyself, Lord, we pray that they would not see these restrictions lifted and go back to normality of life, go back to a sinful way of living. Lord, we pray for a turning to thyself. Bring it about, we ask of thee, that thy name will be glorified, thy kingdom extended. So bless us now and abide with us as we continue on before thee, for we pray in our Saviour's worthy and precious name. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing another hymn. It's 208. Sound the gospel of grace abroad. There's life in the risen Lord. Spread the news of the gift of God. There's life in the risen Lord. God above desires it. Sinful man requires it. Number 208. And join in once again, please.
Thank you.
want to turn in the Word of God now to take our scripture reading from Mark's Gospel chapter 1. And we're going to begin reading at verse 29 of this chapter. Mark's Gospel chapter 1. And we're reading from verse 29 down to the end of the chapter. And forthwith when they were come out of the synagogue, they entered into the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. But Simon's wife's mother lay sick of a fever, and anon they tell him of her. And he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and immediately the fever left her, and she ministered unto them. And at even when the sun did set, they brought unto him all that were diseased, and them that were possessed with devils, and all the city was gathered together at the door. And he healed many that were sick of divers diseases, and cast out many devils, and suffered not the devils to speak, because they knew him. And in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place, and there prayed. And Simon and they that were with him followed after him. And when they had found him, they said unto him, All men seek for thee. And he said unto them, Let us go into the next towns, that I may preach there also, for therefore came I forth. And he preached in their synagogues throughout all Galilee, cast out devils. And there came a leper to him, beseeching him, and kneeling down to him, and saying unto him, If thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus, moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him, and saith unto him, I will, be thou clean. And as soon as he had spoken, immediately the leprosy departed from him, and he was cleansed. And he straightway charged him, and forthwith sent him away, and saith unto him, See thou say nothing to any man, but go thy way, show thyself to the priest, and offer for thy cleansing those things which Moses commanded, for a testimony unto them. But he went out and began to publish it much, and to blaze abroad the matter, insomuch that Jesus could no more openly enter into the city, but was without in desert places, and they came to him from every quarter. Amen. We know the Lord will add his blessing to the reading of his word this evening to all of our hearts. On four separate occasions, we read in the Gospels of the Lord Jesus Christ touching someone. We've actually read of two of them this evening in the Bible reading here from Mark's Gospel chapter 1. The Lord Jesus never was afraid to touch a needy soul. He never contacted any physical or ceremonial uncleanness in doing so. That was because of the power that was in the Lord Jesus Christ. Defilement, whether it was physical or ceremonial, had to give way before him. And whoever he touched, then that individual recovered of their infirmity and they were no longer defiled. And that's why, therefore, the Lord Jesus wasn't able to touch individuals and never be ceremonially unclean, as it would have been among the Jews, at least until the evening. But because the Lord Jesus healed individuals and took away all the defilement and all the uncleanness, whatever it was, then the Saviour never was at any time either physically or ceremonially unclean. Now, each one of these occasions when the Saviour touched an individual illustrates for us something of the work of grace that the Lord Jesus performs in the heart and life of a sinner whom he saves. And we want to think particularly of one of these this evening. But before we do that, we're going to consider very briefly the four of them. Because if you go back to Matthew's Gospel, and it's chapter 9 of Matthew's Gospel, and verse 29... you will find there one of those occasions. It says, Then touched he their eyes, saying, According to your faith be it unto you. And here the Lord Jesus is dealing with blind Bartimaeus and his companion as well, because there were two of them sitting along the wayside begging. And the Lord Jesus touched blind Bartimaeus. And you'll remember how it was that he cried out, Thou son of David, have mercy upon me. And the Lord Jesus stopped and had Bartimaeus brought to him. And he touched his eyes, it tells us there in Matthew 9 and verse 29. And he gave him back his sight and the sight of his companion as well. And that's what the Lord Jesus does when he enters into a person's life and saves that individual. He touches their eyes in the spiritual sense. He opens their eyes to give them understanding. They begin to see their need of the Lord Jesus as their Savior. They begin to see something of their sinfulness in the eyes of a holy God. And they realize that they need to come to Christ for salvation. So the Lord enlightens the mind. He gives an understanding of the things of God and an understanding of the need of Christ. So you have there the touch of enlightenment. And then if you go over to Matthew's Gospel chapter 7, and it's verse 14 in Luke's Gospel chapter 7, you will find there the touch of enlivenment. Because here the Lord Jesus is coming into the city of Nain, a city in Galilee. And as he's coming into the city of Nain, there's a funeral procession on its way out of the city, heading to the burial. And there is a young man who is on his way to be buried, the only son of his widowed mother. But in Luke chapter 7 and verse 14, it says, "And he came," that's the Lord Jesus, "and touched the bier and said, and they that bare him stood still, and he said, Young man, I say unto thee, arise." So the Savior here touches the coffin that's carrying this young man to his burial. And he gives these words, "Young man, I say unto thee, arise." So here was a life-giving touch. This young man was dead and being taken to his burial. The Savior said to his mother, "Weep not." And the reason was that he was going to raise this young man to life. One of three occasions when the Lord Jesus raised the dead to life during his earthly ministry. But here you have the touch of enlivenment. And does the Lord Jesus not do that when he enters into a person's life? Does he not touch them and make them alive? Are we not dead in trespasses and in sins naturally? And does the Lord not give us that touch from himself, a divine touch that brings about a spiritual enlivenment? There's new life in Christ. It's called regeneration, where that old nature is regenerated and given spiritual life. So you have the touch of enlivenment. And then back in Mark chapter 1, where we have been reading, you have the touch of empowerment. Because we read here about the Lord Jesus coming into the home of Simon Peter and Andrew. And it tells us there in verse 30 of Mark 1 that Simon's wife's mother lay sick of a fever. And they tell the Lord Jesus about her. And she's very ill because Luke uses the word fever as well. And the word there has the idea, he calls it a great fever. In Luke chapter 4 and verse 38, he calls it a great fever. And the word fever here, it comes from a verb that has to do with fire. And it gives you some indication of the raging and temperature and infection that this individual had. And it tells us that the Lord Jesus touched her. He touched her. And verse 31, "And he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and immediately the fever left her, and she ministered unto them." And it's Matthew who indicates to us that the Lord Jesus actually touched her at this particular time. It's Matthew 8, verse 15, "And he touched her, and the fever left her, and she arose and ministered unto them." So the Lord Jesus touched Peter's wife's mother. And in touching her, he healed her of this raging fever that she had. And the interesting point that we're told here is that she immediately arose and ministered unto them. What a marvelous recovery was known there in verse 31. Immediately the fever left her and she ministered unto them. And again, is that not an illustration of what the Lord does in a life that he saves? He comes in and he touches that life and he changes that life and he empowers that individual, and immediately they're new creatures in Christ. Immediately they can begin to serve God and live for Christ. And exactly what happened to Simon's mother-in-law is an illustration of what happens in the life of any sinner that the Lord saves. So you have the touch of empowerment. And then there's this fourth one that we want to come to dwell upon a little longer this evening. It's the touch of eradication. The touch of eradication. Because here the Saviour is touching a leper. He's touching a leper. And if you come down here to verse 40 and 41, it says, There came a leper to him, beseeching him, and kneeling down to him, and saying unto him, If thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus, moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him, and saith unto him, I will, be thou clean. So here's another occasion when the Lord touches an individual. And here it's the touch of eradication, because the Lord is going to eradicate this leprosy from this man's life entirely. And he's going to make him clean. You have those words there at the end of verse 41. I will be thou clean. So here's the touch of eradication as the Lord eradicates this leprosy from this man entirely. So here's the fourth of these occasions in the scriptures when the Lord touches an individual. And I want us to consider this touch upon the leper a little longer than those others that we have been briefly mentioned. I want you to consider here in this miracle where the Lord eradicates leprosy from this man's life. I want you to consider this miracle's testimony to the character of Jesus Christ. To the character of Jesus Christ. And what we're going to do is look at each of the gospel accounts regarding this man's healing. Because Matthew, Mark and Luke all record this incident. And each one gives us something that we can particularly consider. And when you turn over to Matthew's account in Matthew chapter 8, you will find there how Matthew mentions this miracle and what he has to say about it. And it tells us there in Matthew chapter 8 and verse 1 to 4, when he was come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him, and behold, there came a leper worshipping him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. Immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And what you discover here is this is the first miracle that Matthew records the Saviour performing. Now, it wasn't the Saviour's first miracle that he did. We know that the first miracle that he did was the turning of the water into wine in Cana of Galilee. John tells us that very clearly in John's Gospel, that that was the first miracle that the Saviour did. But this is the first miracle that Matthew records that the Saviour did. And that's highly significant. There is a reason why Matthew would record that this is the very first miracle that the Saviour did during his earthly ministry. Because remember that Matthew's gospel is significant in that it is the gospel to the Jews. Matthew set out to convince his fellow Jews that Jesus of Nazareth was indeed the Messiah. That's why he often quotes the Old Testament, often quotes that prophecies are being fulfilled, as it is written. And oftentimes Matthew takes the reader back to some Old Testament prophecy because he is seeking to convince his fellow Jews that Jesus Christ, Jesus of Nazareth, is indeed the Christ. He's the Messiah. He's the fulfillment of all of these Old Testament prophecies. And Matthew is drawing attention to them one after another as you go through Matthew's gospel. And when he comes to refer to the Saviour's miracles, this is the very first miracle that he records in chapter 8. This healing of the leper, this eradicating from the life of the leper, this disease of leprosy. And that's significant for a couple of reasons. You see, leprosy was looked upon among the Jews as a particular mark of God's displeasure. Leprosy was looked upon among the Jews as a particular mark of God's displeasure. You think of some individuals who were smitten with leprosy in the Old Testament. Miriam was smitten with leprosy because of what she said, because of how she acted against Moses. And we discover there back in the Old Testament that Miriam was smitten with leprosy. What about the servant of Elisha? Gehazi? Remember how he had gone after Naaman and taken from Naaman that which Elisha wouldn't take from Naaman? And when Gehazi came back into Elisha's house. Elisha challenged him about it and told him that the leprosy of Naaman would come upon him. And then there's one of the kings, Uzziah, who tried to be the priest in Israel as well as the king in Israel, wanted to enter into the house of God and offer the sacrifice. And he could not do that because he was not of the Levitical tribe. He was king, but he could not be priest in the land of Israel, kingdom of Judah. And he was smitten with leprosy. So there's a few examples of individuals who were smitten with leprosy, and they were looked upon as marks of God's displeasure upon an individual. The other point that is significant as well about leprosy and the fact that Matthew would record this as the very first miracle that the Savior did, the removal of the disease of leprosy was believed to come only and directly from the hand of God. That is why it was committed over to the priests to oversee this matter, because it was felt and believed that earthly physicians could not cure this disease of leprosy. And that's why when you go back there to Leviticus and you read about those requirements for the leper, he wasn't to go to the physician in Israel, he was to go to the priest in Israel. It was the priest that was to oversee his exclusion and then his reintegration into the camp when the disease would disappear. That was all in the hands of the priest, because it was viewed among the Jews that only God directly could ever recover someone of their leprosy. It is believed that as leprosy came directly from the hand of God and was a sign of his displeasure, then it follows on that only God can remove that. That's why the king of Israel cried out in despair when Naaman was sent to him. In 2 Kings 5 and verse 7, you read there, "Am I God to kill and to make alive, that this man doth send unto me to recover a man of his leprosy?" The king was horrified that Naaman would stand at his door and expect to be delivered of his leprosy, for the simple reason that only God, according to the Jews, this was the mindset among the Jews, only God could deliver a man from his leprosy. And here's Naaman outside the door of the king's house, looking forward to the king to recover him of his leprosy. And that's why the king cries out as he does, "Am I God to kill and to make alive, that this man doth send unto me to recover a man of his leprosy?" So there was this mindset among the Jews that only God directly could recover an individual from their leprosy. And that's why Matthew then recording the healing of a leper, the eradicating of leprosy from an individual's life, that this would be the first miracle that is recorded that the Savior has done in Matthew's gospel, is very significant. Because is it not highlighting some particular points that Matthew wants to make about the person of Jesus Christ and the work of Jesus Christ? Does Matthew not want to emphasize that Jesus Christ is the one who's able to remove the displeasure, yea, the wrath of God from off the sinner? Is that not the purpose of Mark's, of Matthew's gospel and all the gospels as well? Is that not the purpose of the word of God as it comes to us this evening? Wherever you might read it, is there not conveyed to us in this book, this message, that Jesus Christ is able to remove from off you and me the displeasure, yea, the wrath of God? The Bible reminds us that we are under condemnation already. We are condemned already. It's not that somehow we have to wait a future day until all our deeds are weighed up in the balance somehow, and then an individual may be condemned before God. No, the Bible tells us we are condemned already. We are condemned already. We are under condemnation. The sentence of God's wrath is upon us already. The displeasure of God rests upon all of mankind because of our sins and our sinfulness. And Jesus Christ came to turn away the displeasure of God. He came there to hang upon the cross, to extinguish the wrath of God, to eradicate the wrath of God. For those who are Christ, those who will believe on him, John chapter 5 and verse 24 says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth in him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life." So those who believe on him, he said himself, shall not come into condemnation. The wrath of God will not abide on them any longer. It will pass away. So Christ has come to take away the wrath of God. And here's the significance of Matthew referring to a leper as the very first miracle that the Lord Jesus did. It's because this thought among the Jews that leprosy was a sign of a displeasure upon an individual. And here's the Lord Jesus touching a leper and healing a leper, eradicating the disease of leprosy from that man's body entirely. And is Matthew not illustrating this point? Jesus Christ is the only one who can remove from off us the wrath of God. Otherwise, that wrath will fall upon us someday. If we do not know Christ, if we do not hear his word and believe on him, as John 5 and 24 tells us, we will come into condemnation then. The wrath of God will abide on us and fall upon us as well. But Jesus Christ came to take away sin. That's how he's going to remove the wrath of God, because it's sin that brings the wrath of God upon us. And Jesus Christ came to deal with sin, as John the Baptist said on that day when he cried out, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." That's how we escape the wrath of God. We need our sins taken away. Our sins have to be removed. Just like the leprosy being eradicated from that man's body, so sin has to be eradicated. Sin has to be dealt with in our lives. And it's only by the dealing with sin that you and I can escape the wrath of God. And only Jesus Christ can deal with sin. There's no other Savior. There's no other Savior. He alone is the Savior. He alone can deal with this matter of taking away the wrath of God. And he did it by coming to deal with sin there upon the cross. But the other point as well is that only God can take away leprosy from an individual. Is Matthew not seeking to convey that Jesus Christ is God manifest in the flesh? Is that not a purpose of Matthew's gospel and the other gospels as well? But certainly Matthew's gospel, is he not setting out to prove that Jesus Christ is indeed God manifest in the flesh? In Matthew chapter 11 and verse 5, there's an answer that is given to a query that came, because there were disciples from John the Baptist who came. John is in prison, and he sent two of his disciples. Matthew 11 and in verse 3, he told the disciples to go and ask the Lord Jesus, "Art thou he that should come, or do we look for another?" And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Go and show John again those things which ye do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk, that lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached unto them." So here are the proofs of his messiahship. When John's disciples asked the question, "Are you the one who's promised to come, or do we look for another?" the Lord Jesus says, "Here's the evidence." And one of the evidences was lepers cleansed. The leper cleansed is the proof of who Christ is. And he is the Son of God. Only in the mindset of the Jews, only God could deal with a leper. Only God could cleanse a leper. Only God could eradicate leprosy from an individual's life. And here at the very beginning of Matthew recording miracles that the Savior did, he turns him to think about the leper and the touch of the Savior upon that leper's life and the eradication of the leprosy. Is he not seeking to convey that he is God manifest in the flesh? You see, we need a divine Savior. The touch that you and I need in order to save our souls and to deliver us from the wrath of God is a divine touch. Only one who is divine, only one who is the equal of God the Father, can extinguish the wrath of God. Only one who is the eternal Son, co-equal with his Father, can become the sacrifice for sin and deal with sin upon the cross. And Jesus Christ is that individual. So the touch of the Lord here upon the leper is highly significant as you consider it in Matthew's gospel. And may we be those who realize it's Jesus Christ I need. It's the touch of the Master I need in my life that will eradicate the wrath of God and deal with my sins. The second thing I want us to consider is here from Mark's gospel, and it's this miracle's testimony to the compassion of Christ. So Matthew's testifying to the character of Christ. Mark is here using this miracle, this eradication of leprosy, as a testimony to the compassion of Christ. It's verse 41 of Mark's gospel, chapter 1. It says, Jesus moved with compassion. Now Matthew doesn't mention this aspect of compassion. Neither does Luke mention this aspect of compassion. Mark is the only individual who emphasizes this aspect of this miracle, where the Savior had compassion. This is what draws the healing virtue out of Christ. This is why the Savior eradicates the leprosy out of this man's life. It's because he had compassion upon him. He had compassion upon him. We're reminded here of the merciful nature of our Savior. We can use the words of Hebrews 2:17, where it speaks there that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest. Now remember the context in Israel where a person with leprosy had to go to the priest. And here's this leper coming to the Lord Jesus, it tells us. There in verse 40, and there came a leper to him, beseeching him. Well, Jesus Christ is the great high priest, greater than Aaron and any other of the high priests that were in Israel. Christ is the high priest, and he's one who's full of mercy. He's one who's full of compassion, just as it tells us over there in Hebrews 2:17. He's a merciful high priest, as well as being a faithful high priest. He's a merciful high priest. He's full of compassion. He's full of compassion for the needy. He's full of compassion for lost souls. Here he touches the untouchable. That's a measure of his compassion. He touches the leper. Nobody else would touch a leper in Israel. As you know, the leper had to cry out, unclean, unclean, and people would have avoided the leper. But not Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ in his compassion comes and he touches this leper. He touches this leper. He doesn't tell him to stay away. He doesn't tell him to keep his distance. He comes beseeching the Lord Jesus. He comes kneeling down to the Lord Jesus. And instead of turning him away and having nothing to do with him, the Lord Jesus, it says, he's moved with compassion. And he puts forth his hand and he touched him. He touches the untouchable. Such is the compassion that there is in the Lord Jesus Christ. How great is his compassion? How far reaching is his compassion? We were singing that hymn at the very beginning of our broadcast. Oh, how wonderful, how marvelous is my Savior's love to me. And isn't the love of God, the mercy of God, something to marvel at? Is it not something to stand and to be amazed at today? For all that he would do, that he would have mercy upon a poor individual, a needy individual. Was that not exactly what the Lord has done towards those who are sinners? Do we not rejoice in the love of God and the mercy of God, the compassion of God towards sinners? That there is a salvation, that there is a way of escape this evening? Is this not something to marvel at? Is this not something to take note of? Even as Mark here emphasizes the compassion that Christ had upon this individual. Matthew doesn't mention it and Luke doesn't mention it, but Mark emphasizes it. Is it not something tonight to stop at and to consider and ponder? The compassion of Christ upon poor sinners. And here's the reason why we need to stop and consider this. Because the power to heal this individual and to recover this leper from his leprosy, to eradicate that from his life, is motivated by his pity towards that individual. See, there was nothing in this individual to deserve this healing. Just as there's nothing in a sinner to deserve salvation. There's nothing good in us. We're just like the leper from the top of our head to the sole of our foot. There's nothing but defilement and uncleanness. There's nothing in the sinner at all to deserve any blessing from God, any mercy from God. There's nothing at all. Where does it come from? It comes alone from the compassion of Christ. It's his pity upon poor sinners. It's his compassion upon poor sinners that brings him from heaven, that keeps him on the cross, that would open up a way of salvation tonight, that there is a gospel to preach, that there is a means of having sin eradicated from our lives, just like leprosy was from this man's life. It all comes back to the mercy and to the grace of God. As we are reminded there in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 7 of the blessings that come to those who are in Christ. It says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. And then it adds these words, according to the riches of his grace. Oh, this is how it is brought about. Here are the blessings. We have redemption through the blood. We have forgiveness of sins. But where does that all come from? It comes from the riches of his grace. And tonight, salvation flows out of the mercy of God towards a poor sinner. And may we be the recipients of that mercy. Remember, there's nothing good in us. There's nothing deserving in us. You don't have to deserve salvation to have it. You don't have to deserve salvation. You don't somehow have to make yourself fit enough for salvation. You just come as you are. It's the mercy of God you need. And the Bible presents him as one who is merciful. Rich in mercy. Rich in grace. That's what you need to think about. Not trying to make yourself better. Not trying to bring yourself to a state where you feel you deserve salvation. That will never happen. No, the sinner just needs to come as they are. Cast yourself upon the mercy of God. That's what you need to do tonight. Just cast yourself upon the mercy of God. And he will save you. He most certainly will. There's one further thing I want us to consider. And here we're going to turn over to the Gospel of Luke and think about this as Luke records this for us. It's Luke chapter 5 that you find this account in, beginning there at verse 12. And the third thing I want us to consider is this miracle's testimony to the cleansing power of Christ. The cleansing power of Christ. Remember, the Lord is touching this individual. And in touching him, he's going to do something for him. And the point I want you to notice here from Luke's Gospel, chapter 5, that Matthew and Mark don't emphasize, is that this man was full of leprosy. You'll find that in verse 12. It came to pass when he was in a certain city, behold, a man full of leprosy, who seeing Jesus fell on his face and besought him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. So here's a man who's absolutely full of leprosy. It's not just a wee spot. It's not just something that's very localized. Here's a man who's absolutely full of leprosy. It's in every part of his body. But what we find here is a Savior who's willing and who is able to cleanse him. A Savior who is willing and who is able to cleanse him. This man who's full of leprosy. The Lord Jesus is able to cleanse him. Think something there about his petition for his cleansing. Because he falls before the Lord Jesus, he beseeches him and he says to the Lord Jesus, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. He petitions the Lord. But he's not asking something that is too great. He's not asking something that is beyond Christ to do. This man is full of leprosy and he needs cleansing. But Christ is able to cleanse him. Of that there is no doubt. Christ is able to eradicate from this man's life, full of leprosy as he is, Christ is able to eradicate from his life this leprosy in its entirety. And here's this man coming, and he's beseeching the Lord, and he's saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. If you will. He didn't doubt his ability. He didn't doubt his ability at all. This leper came to the Lord with this conviction, the Lord is able to cleanse me, even though I am full of leprosy. He did not doubt his ability. And sinner tonight, do not doubt Christ's ability to save. Do not doubt the ability of the cleansing blood to cleanse you from your sins, and to wash you and to make you clean. Do not doubt that for a moment. Christ is both able and he is willing. He is willing. Because that brings us then to think about the pronouncement here of his cleansing. Because the Lord, in response to this request, wilt, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. It says there, verse 13, Luke 5, 13, he put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. The Lord pronounced him to be clean. More than that, the Lord made him clean. He's thoroughly cleansed from his leprosy. It follows on there that it tells you that the end of that verse 13, immediately the leprosy departed from him. These weren't empty words that the Lord Jesus spoke when he indicated his willingness to heal this man and to eradicate this leprosy from his life. They weren't empty words. When he pronounced those words, I will, be thou clean. It wasn't that nothing happened. It says immediately the leprosy departed from this man. I want you to think about another I will of Christ. John chapter 6 verse 37, all that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. The sinner can depend on Christ's willingness to save. Oh, you've no reason to doubt his power. No reason at all to doubt the power of the cleansing blood. You have no reason either to doubt his willingness to save. He will save. Oh, just like he responded here to this man, Lord, if thou wilt, the Savior said, I will, be thou clean. And you can trust in Christ's willingness to save you this evening. Why don't you put him to the test? Why don't you call upon him just like this man here cried out to him? Why don't you come to Christ and call upon him, and you'll find a Savior willing to save. Able to save, willing to save. But I want you also here to consider something about the procedure of his cleansing. Because the Lord instructed this man to do something after he was cleansed. It says there in verse 14, Luke 5, 14, and he charged him to tell no man, but go and show thyself to the priest, and offer for thy cleansing according as Moses commanded, for a testimony unto them. Now there's some things to notice here, because remember, the priest must officially declare an individual to be clean. And as that was the law of leprosy that was then in existence in the land of Israel, the Lord Jesus was subject to that law, and this man is subject to that law. And he tells him, go along to the priest, have the priest pronounce you to be clean, have him to declare that you are indeed free from this leprosy. But does that not remind us of the need of sinners and their need of a declaration of being clean? It's called justification. Isn't justification that legal term before God as the judge? You're declared to be justified in God's sight. You're declared to be free from sin. In the sense, the penalty of sin is not there anymore. It's been removed. Sin has been answered for by the Lord Jesus on your behalf. We're justified in Christ. His merit has been imputed to us. And we're declared to be justified. We're declared to be clean. Well, is that not here emphasized when you think about what the Lord Jesus said to this man that he needed to do? Then he was to offer the sacrifice for his cleansing. This was going to acknowledge the part that the Lord had in it, that this was indeed of God, and it would be for thanksgiving. And when someone comes to know Christ and has sin dealt with in their life, is it not a cause of thanksgiving? Should we not indeed praise the Lord for all that he has done? When he has eradicated sin from our lives. And then the Lord said it was to be a testimony unto them as well. A living witness that the great healer was among them. That Christ, that God indeed had visited his people. It's to be a testimony to the priests in the temple. This man has a leprosy eradicated from him. There's the God man who is at work in the world at that particular time. He was in the land of Israel. He was ministering among them. God had visited his people. He says, offer the sacrifice. It'll be a testimony unto them. And that Christian who knows Christ has indeed a testimony. Testimony to what the Lord has done. And then you have the postscript there that comes at the end of this, because it tells us that instead of being quiet until he had shown himself to the priest, that's what the Lord said to him, that he was to tell no man until he had shown himself unto the priest. That man goes out immediately and begins to publish it. Oh, he couldn't do anything else. Mark's Gospel there, verse 45, it says he went out and began to publish it much, to blaze abroad the matter. No, he couldn't stop but tell it. He couldn't do anything else but to tell what the Lord had done for him. What an amazing thing had happened, the touch of the Master, eradicating leprosy from his life. Do you know the touch of Christ tonight, eradicating sin, dealing with sin in your life? Can you testify to that? Can you rejoice in that? Can you tell others of that? That you've been touched by the Master. And that your sins are gone. You're cleansed and washed and made clean. Oh, may we tonight rejoice in the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus Christ. May the Lord bless his word this evening to all of our hearts for his name's sake. We're going to bow together in prayer for a moment, and then we're going to sing one final hymn. Our Father, we thank thee for the power that is in the Lord Jesus and for his willingness to manifest that power out of his pity and compassion. And we pray that we might indeed be all recipients of that mercy. May we know the cleansing power. Oh, may sin be eradicated from our lives. May we be clean. Lord, wash us. Make us clean even tonight. And may there be some soul who will even call upon thee, cast themselves upon thy mercy and thy willingness to save them. Oh, may that be so. Bless thy word, we pray. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing one final hymn in closing. It's 227. Is there a heart that is waiting, longing for pardon today? Hear the glad message proclaiming, Jesus is passing this way. It's 227. And join in as you see the words coming up on the screen.
Thank you.
I trust the Lord has blessed his word this evening to your heart. And if we can be of any help to you, give you any spiritual counsel, there's contact details that come up on the screen. Feel free to make contact with us. We certainly would exhort you to come to know Christ if you don't know him as your Lord and Saviour. May the Lord bless.